My name is Ron Raines, and I'm a gay Mormon. I'm 60 years old, and I'm married to Sue, who has been my partner in life for 36 years next month. And we are the parents of three children, all grown up now, and we're empty nested. I joined the church when I was 18 and did all the Mormon thing. I really didn't want to be a gay boy, and I was hoping that the Mormon church was right when they said that it could go away if I just didn't program. That didn't really work after a few decades. I've been out a couple of, I've been out for about 15 years to Sue and about 10 years to my family and about 5 or 6 years to my ward family. We are attending a church with progressive beliefs, and it's been really difficult in the last year, frankly. We're now attending about half the time, and we've struggled with how to reconcile our faith versus policy and cultural practice in the church and in our ward. So that is my brief story. I'm going to let the others tell their story.
Ron, could you have people stand up?
Hi, my name's Cameron. I'm from Seattle. I served my mission in Utah. I've been home for 3 years, and I came out to my mom and to the world a couple months ago, just in November. And I've been out to a few friends longer than that. And I'm happy to be here. There are a lot of gay people in Seattle. The reason I'm here is because I'm a gay man.
My name is Owen Rowell. I'm 70 years old. I'm active, gay Mormon. I moved into a new ward 7 weeks ago. And before that, I was teaching high preschool in my old ward. I am married to a woman. I do not live with her. We both have a mutual understanding. She doesn't want to be divorced, so we're not divorced. I live with Tim. My bishop knows that. My old bishop knew that. The state president knows that. And they're fine.
Hi, my name is Kathleen Ashley. I was born and raised in the Los Angeles area, but currently hail from Auburn, Washington. I've also lived in Hawaii, Portland for a couple of years, and Salt Lake for about 6 months. I'm 34. I came out just under 3 years ago in an effort to, I came out as bisexual in an effort to help my parents, especially my mom, not be so hard on my 10 years younger gay brother. And quite a long way in accepting myself as a thing. I originally came out as bisexual. I still feel that that applies, but it generally helps me figure out that the other piece to that is that I'm homoromantic. I've never fallen in love with a man. And so I'm currently single and attempting to date women for the first time.
My name is Katie Jones, and I live in Seattle, Washington. I grew up in Utah, and I lived there until I was 8, and then I moved to Washington. I'm an inactive pansexual trans man.
My name is Caroline Lee. I'm Caden's partner, actually, for over 2 years. I am a pansexual trans woman, and I was born and raised in Houston, Texas. I came out about 5 years ago, at which point I was kicked out, and then I moved to Seattle to be with this guy.
Hey, Caitlin and Carolyn, some people back at our table are asking what pansexual means.
Well,
why don't you explain that?
Pansexual basically means that it doesn't really matter what genitalia the person has. If you're attracted to them in general and attracted to them romantically, then you don't have a problem being with them. It has very little to do with gender and more to do with general attraction and connection. These are me.
A good phrase is hearts, not hearts.
Yes.
It impacts me because I believe in a loving God, and I believe that we're all family and brothers and sisters with each other. And I still believe in a God that has high standards for us. And I think that's been a blessing in my life.
I had a little fall, so that's why I'm having a hard time being happy now. Being a member of the church is important to me because through my membership I can feel complete in the gospel, which I believe in very much and have since I was 16. I have decided that my sexual orientation is not a hindrance to me, and apparently it isn't to other people who think about it.
I grew up the daughter of many years in the church family on one side, and on my father's side, strong converts. I've spent 2016, what I feel like is inactive, but it's on the less active side. I guess going once a month means that you're still somewhat active. But I've shifted into somewhat of an agnostic realm of I'd like to believe in certain things. I'd like to believe in God and in Christ. I don't use the terminology that I know anymore. I used to say I know this and I know that. I feel that is not knowledge. It's always been a horrible feeling for me. I've felt strongly about deity. I've felt strongly about feelings of what I have termed the Holy Ghost. But I do not know exactly that that's what it is. I've been in, I guess, a faith transition, and where I once was, I grew up very, very strongly in the church, very much, guided by young women's and going to girls' camp, and I went to BYU Hawaii. I thought seriously about a mission, and that didn't feel right for me. I very much wanted to find a husband and get married in the temple and have kids, and I wanted that to be a part of my life. Coming to terms with my sexuality, I questioned whether any of that could, I mean, I don't want to marry somebody that I'm not in love with, so I'm having to restructure how I approach my life. So I think my Mormon approach to life is currently in the process of something I'm restructuring, my expectations for, which has been very hard. I feel like it's somewhat an abandonment of self. But I'm trying to see it as an acceptance of who I really am that I have pushed away for so long.
For me, it's a little bit difficult to connect my gender transition with Mormonism because I left the church before I knew I was trans. And I left the church. I've known that I was attracted to both genders since I was about, I saw Lizzie when I was about 14. That's around the time when I stopped going to church, but it was mostly in part because my parents had gotten divorced and my dad was no longer going to church, so it was more difficult to go than to not go. And it felt more, I felt more pressure when I was going to church, more from my peers of my fellow age at the time. And that could be gender related. I mean, because I was in Young Women's and all that. And just the relationships I had with the women there didn't feel personal and authentic to me. And that was one of the biggest things that drove me away, honestly. It wasn't really the beliefs or questioning of values that has ever been my problem. I always believed that, like, the Mormon God's a good, loving God. I've never felt like he's a God of fear. And that is something that I'm grateful for. I don't have very many bad things to say about the church because my mom is still very, very active, and I see what good it brings in her life, and I know that, like, it brings her a lot of good. So, you know, who am I to judge that? But personally for me, the church just isn't an active part of my life at this time. But I do have a lot of ingrained qualities and values from growing up in the church, all for me, which were positive. And maybe that's because I'm no longer struggling with the church because I am an active. So I don't have to go to church every week and have my identity challenged, which would be much harder if I were going every week. That would be much harder than being inactive. Inactive is easier, and that I know for sure, but I also don't feel loss or pain, and maybe that's just because it's been years since I've been active, but it's shaped me in a good way, I like to believe.
My Mormonism has impacted me very strongly, even though I joined the church when I was 18. I think it fit in well with my own family's ethics. And it is who I am today. We've built a life around serving in the church, and I'm no longer serving in the church, but I'm serving here and I'm serving in other ways. And, you know, I think that Mormonism has a real ethic or a real desire to be close to God, to receive inspiration and guidance from Him, and that follows with me whether or not I'm an active LDS person. So besides service, desire for spirituality, I would say also that strong family ethic that's been ingrained that we build our family around, that the sense of family, everyone's family is important. And I don't see how we can make or distinguish a difference that LGBT families are any less than or not as important as the other families that exist and flourish in the LDS Church. All families are important. All need to be recognized and nurtured and supported. So I think, to me, all of those things, why does it matter? Because I think that they're right. And that sense of fairness and right, I think, is also something that I've acquired in the LDS Church.
I've been a believer in the gospel and in the church for 54 years. I've come to the conclusion in my life that each and every one of us is on a spiritual journey, whether we recognize it or understand it, is debatable. But we all have individual paths. And to be fulfilled, we have to follow those individual paths. Some of those paths are outside the church. Some are inside the church. Some pass in and out of the church. But there are paths in our relationship with each other and with Heavenly Father. And that is how I see it.
In my family of origin, I failed to mention that my grandfather, my dad's dad, never converted to Mormonism. He was Muslim until his death. And so I do have Muslim and Christian and Mormon and non-religious members of my family on my father's side. And when I moved up to Washington, I had an opportunity to get to know some of my extended family members. Part of the beauty of living in the Northwest, my great grandparents actually lived in Battleground, Washington, just a little bit north of here. And my great grandmother is died and is buried there. So I do have, a closeness to my family in this area. But I've been getting to know my aunt, who lives in Silverdale, Washington now. And this aunt is my grandfather's younger sister, who was born in Jerusalem, along with all of her brothers, including my grandfather. And when we have family reunions, her remark is always, you know, the beautiful thing about our family is that we come from different areas. We come from Southern California. Some people fly in from the old world, from Israel, from Washington, and from various other states. We come together with different religious backgrounds. And we come together at different ages, the old, the young. And we get together and we tell stories. We tell our stories. And we have fun together and we love each other, no matter the diversity that, and including racial diversity, that is within our family. And that's what, and she says, that's what makes a family a family, is we get together and we share, and we enjoy each other, and we love each other, despite all of our differences. And I think that in thinking in terms of the Affirmation family, I think that when we come together, we hear these stories, and it's important to be open to others' truth, and something that I've actually been able to focus on by participating in Kendall Wilcox's program called Circles of Empathy. I've participated in two different groups, and those are group therapy groups. The ones I've been in have been largely LGBT Mormon related. And the focus is using I statements. Never saying we generally, or speaking for the group. Always speaking to the self and my experience and my truth. And I think
that my focus in learning how to speak from myself and not putting expectations or judgments on other people,
that's been something that I think is a way that we can come together and share our individual. I can share my individual, we can change it to an I statement. I can share my individual experience and not project that is anybody else's path.
I guess shortly, to me, like the spiritual diversity in groups like this, like Affirmation for, they represent a bigger community of LGBT people. To me, it doesn't really matter what your spiritual background is, like in the fine print, I guess. Like the main difference between religions really is what text is used in that religion, what verses are important, and what practices are done. But what really matters are the values that are carried in those religions. And so if together as a community, as an LGBT community, you just focus on the values that your religion's given you, like love or family or, respect and things like that, those are the things that should really fuel your spiritual experience, and you should focus on those aspects when you're working in a queer community like this, rather than focusing on specific verses or specific prophets or things like that, because those do change depending on religion and depending on denomination and things like that. So using the qualities and the values that are given through your religion rather than like fine print.
Nitpicky things that pull people apart rather than pull people together.
I appreciate what you said, Kathleen, about your grandmother and how you come together and you share stories and you express love for one another. And that's what we try to do in Affirmation conferences and in the exchange of ideas in Affirmation Facebook groups, that we support one another. And we can learn empathy when we feel of each other's hearts and we understand the details of our diverse experiences. And so when people talk to me about trans people and they're starting to go off about who uses the bathroom, I can begin to respond based on the basis of people that I know and their stories and what life means to them in their relationships. And it's because I have that richness of detail about how people are explaining their lives. It brings me to be able to defend and explain and hopefully generate greater understanding among people who don't have a clue about the trans experience. Last year, we had a panel in our evening program at Affirmation in Provo, where we had half a dozen members of our family, our Affirmation family, talk about their experience. And I reflected on that. And so as we share our stories, our diverse paths, we give each other details about how we live. There are many of you that don't have a clue what it's like to be in a mixed orientation marriage, but you hear me talk, or my wife talk, or others talk, and you begin to get a clue. And so it's important that we share our stories.
I was trying to get kind of a consensus of who might be coming to this conference, and We don't have a huge Seattle representation down here. But a lot of people expressed that after the policy change,
they didn't feel like associated with Mormonism at all. There's a little bit of that. And some felt that Affirmation didn't have a strong enough of a response to such terrible news. I guess there's a little bit of a feeling that there might be too much sympathy not standing up for ourselves, for the people. And I think when you get a policy like that, it's hard. It's a hard thing to respond to. We do have such a wide variety of people and a wide variety of beliefs and different paths on the journey right now. And I think that I understand the sentiment that a lot of former participants, I understand them not wanting to participate in anything that reminds them of such things, and they're trying to move on without Mormonism. I think that there's, to some extent, I can't imagine really fully escaping my Mormon upbringing and the importance that it's played in my life. And that it still does. The bulk of my family, my immediate family, and my closer extended family is Mormon. And I have to continually communicate and participate and love the people that come to me concerned about how I identify and who I'm dating. And Affirmation in my faith journey has provided me with what I think is crucial for me is others who know where I'm at, who have been there, who have stories and helpful words and loving open arms no matter where I'm at. I think that Affirmation should be exemplary in having open arms to all, in loving all no matter where they're at. Definitely providing that space where I don't want to come and feel like I'm judging people for where they're at on their path. And to some extent, it's hard. It's hard for all of us. It's hard for me to not think, how can this person be in this space, in this place? And I think, well, maybe that was me 2 years ago. Maybe I'm going to be in that space in another 2 years. With that perspective of knowing how changeable I am, I feel that I've seen that exemplified in a lot of the people within this organization.
And I'm grateful for that openness. And I guess I would urge each of us to consider how we can continue to just reach out to everyone to let them know that they're loved and welcome, and allow those who aren't ready or wanting to participate in the space, but just keeping the open arms.
just really briefly, not to disagree, but my experience has been totally different. I haven't experienced any deficiency with affirmation with regard to the policy change. I personally feel that the tone and tenor of affirmation has been perfect. And I personally like it the way it is. One of the things I like most about affirmation is that nothing is swept under the rug, but nobody seems embittered. Nobody seems aggrieved. Nobody seems angry. And that's something that I really like about affirmation. And I'm grateful for affirmation the way it is.
I think this is a really important question. And we really want to learn. The Northwest represents a culture that's different than Utah. And not better or worse, but different. And Owen and myself, among gay Mormons, are somewhat in the Northwest or somewhat of an anomaly because we're still going to church. Most gay Mormons in the Northwest have moved past. And we've had many former members of Affirmation that are in the Northwest that are no longer attending or participating in Affirmation. And I'm asking the question on board, why not? Why isn't Affirmation more of a long-term culture? Why isn't it, why is it so dependent? Or why is there this pendulum swing or passing through? And so I'm going to ask this same question again. And those of you who are Northwest voices, if you have an answer that you'd like us to know.
How can affirmation improve in function or in services to you as a person, or as a couple? Or is there anyone here who would like to answer, how can we do that?
This is just something I've noticed from when I started coming to affirmation maybe 4 or 5 years ago compared to the experience I have now, is that it primarily, when I would go to the Portland chapter, was a social network. And I think that it's shifted to some degree into a broader sort of religious or pseudo-religious type of structure. And I think that drove some people away. So I personally don't mind that the structure, but I would prefer that the balance shifted a little more to the social.
Thank you, Chef.
Anyone else want to comment on affirmation meeting your needs as a person and as a community?
Yeah, I was thinking, I've only been, this is my second affirmation event, and I just went to the Utah one this last summer. But what I noticed when I was looking at the names of the work groups that are available, workshops, and things of that nature, most of them are targeted with the LGBT in direct correlation to Mormonism, most of the workshops. And so, as someone who's inactive myself, I don't mind talking about Mormonism and how it's affected me, but it's not affecting me now, you know, because I'm not active. So to me, I like being around people who I know have similar backgrounds. So I do have Mormon background, and that's never going to go away. So me being in a room full of people with Mormon background who are also LGBT is enough. And I agree with you, I think I want more of that social interaction, more just sharing your story like, oh, what was the hardest part about coming out, and like discuss that rather than how do you come out in church? Like, that's a very niche topic, you know what I'm saying? So I guess for me, I would think, not necessarily having always that correlation needed, but having, simply for me, having the background that I know everyone here has a Mormon background is enough for me. I don't need more of the spiritual parts in all the groups or in all the discussions.
Hi, I'm Norman. So what I feel is when I first joined Affirmation off of the Facebook group, there was a big public forum for everyone to speak. And then all of a sudden something happened to where we all of a sudden had to go into these boxes. And I really didn't appreciate being put into a box. And I was just hoping and praying that hopefully maybe something can happen to where that free forum of everybody chit-chatting with each other, because I feel like, you know, I'm a part of Affirmation's journeys, and I'm not really getting to know everybody who is here necessarily unless we talk to each other. Other than that, you know, if we have the Facebook forum back to where we can talk to everybody, and then we can all get to know each other once again instead of being in these little boxes. So, thanks.
Great comment, thank you. So we have a lot of...
Oh. How should I put this? I know a lot of gay Mormons in Seattle, and I have heard a lot, especially when I say I'm going to an Affirmation conference. So the comments are this. They said, oh, you need to be validated. You are so uncomfortable with who you are, and you have to go through Affirmation. So there is a misconception that people that come to the conference might be struggling, that need to be validated, but at the same time, it looks like Affirmation is not doing enough to reach out for those who are past the end up. I know people that are ex-Mormons that when I tell them about Affirmation, they are not interested. They also are expecting Affirmation to be a way to connect to the church, to negotiate with the church, to raise the voice of a common community of gay people that are LDS, that we want to have a voice within the church, but that is not happening either. So they've been looking and waiting for something like, you know, we were expecting that someone would negotiate, per se, for us within the church to have a voice there, but it hasn't happened yet. If you ask me personally, I am happy to be here, and I'm happy to meet people, and I don't have expectations that that's me. Some other people are expecting a lot more that we could do for them, reaching out, being in touch, doing something more active as opposed to, and even though putting this conference together is a lot of work, doing the international conference is a lot of work, and some people think that that's not enough, that we're just limiting ourselves to this regional conference, and then we forget about it, and then we do that again the next year, and it's not enough to show that we really care for those who are not here today.
We are blessed with a Portland chapter, a regional group here in the Northwest. There was a Seattle chapter that was fairly active that has a little bit fallen off the map
that we want to reestablish. And I think it's really up to the members of the local chapter to define social events, spiritual events, conferences, whatever floats the boat for that group. And it's up to us to make Affirmation what we want it to be. I guess I hope that there would be more people coming in to have that time together to build friendships and to we have the commonality of a Mormon culture in our backgrounds, and we have the opportunity to support one another if there needs to be support.
I have an answer for you. I am Bambi, yes. You know, some of you got to see my meltdown today in class. So I have my journal entry, and I'm just going to read it because this would be a good future for affirmation for me and those who are allies. But we're not a mama dragon. You know, we're not a dragon dad. We're not a sibling or parent. We just love you. And there was no place for me here this weekend as just when I loved you. So this is what I wrote today. I don't know who I am anymore, but right now I really don't know who I am here. I am not LGBT. My children are not LGBT. I have a mission with and for LGBT people. I am so lost. Plus, I feel empty, raw, frightened, confused, sad. Here I am at the Affirmation Conference, feeling so very out of place. Yet I also remember how excited I was the days leading up to this conference. I wondered if I would find this helpful. I wondered if I would be of help. It has really scared me to feel so unwelcome, almost threatened, or looked down upon, like I am the enemy. Now nobody personally, nobody did anything to me. Like I said in the class, this is all about me. I didn't know much about affirmation. Now I know lots. And I'm thrilled to be able to go to my ward, which is just the branch here, and, you know, cheerlead with, oh, affirmation. You don't have to have someone. You know, if you love these people or you want to advocate or support these people, I know how you can do it, and you can find out the truth from the horse's mouth. Doesn't have to be any things that are not true, but you can come and it'll be okay. So I would like to see in maybe in the future a class for us, you know, so that we can fit in, because we are in your corner. We just don't have a family member.
You fit in and we love you.
My answer was going to be more allies. So,
I think that in considering what the LGBT community needs in general, in the world, especially in the church, is allies who might just wear a little rainbow on their shoulder. Somebody who is willing to come and learn and hear the stories of all the different people represented here. I needed growing up, I wish that I had anybody who I could have talked to about how I was feeling. The world changing in that way. I think that online communities are there.
What's not always there is somebody who's an ally sitting in the pews that maybe is approachable, and that teenager or even that 40-year-old woman in the closet needs somebody to let out their heart to. I know that my own personal experience of coming out, I had friends come out to me who probably will never come out because the climate in the church does not allow that. The climate in their own families does not allow that. But if the climate can change by allies showing up to church with rainbows on their shoulders, if those allies can show up or invite people, help invite them, say, hey, there's a place, there's a group of people that you might want to get to know. I think that's going to be what makes the biggest difference for the future of affirmation. I want the allies to outnumber the LGBT in this group and support and love and share with all the youth, especially all the youth growing up, who will inevitably grow up in the church.
I think that's going to be our future.
I am not personally Mormon, but I was raised Catholic in Babylon. I have a very evangelical father. As a trans woman who currently identifies as atheist, I feel like, at least in my experience, religion didn't necessarily bring me a lot of joy. There was a lot of pain, there was a lot of repression, and there's a lot of that hurt that is still left over. But I attended my first affirmation last year in Utah, and I volunteered with the children. And working with the children, it was amazing to see the joy that was there, the celebration that there was a place where all these people who could come together with similar experiences found each other, and they're like, I'm not alone. I have worth, I have value, I have people who love me. And in contrast, I did see that maybe the adult parts were maybe a little more dour, a little more tempered down, and just as someone who, like you were saying, really needed someone there to relate to and connect to growing up. I just think it would be amazing if the entire affirmation were not just about affirming, but about celebrating, about taking joy and finding each other and celebrating the love that we all have together.
Yeah, I think what they said, other small things about allies. Yeah, I think allies are really, really important to affirmation, because only through allies are you really going to spread the knowledge you need to spread that will kindle the compassion that we need in the church from our members to take away the negativity that is put on LGBT members and just people in general. So I just wanted to second that, I guess.
The affirmation of tomorrow that I would like to see would be a room full of people that would have been with affirmation for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, 7 years. You get the drift. I'd like to see us as a community of friends and family. That we rejoice in
a loving environment where there's no judgment about who you are or who you choose to love or how you choose to live, and that people take strength in that, and that there's a place for everyone in affirmation, and it's not just a rest stop as you're coming out of Mormonism. It needs to be a room full of people with a richness and variety of age and experience and depth. I was really excited that Dwayne Jennings came to our conference so he could tell us a little bit about our history. I've only been in affirmation for 4 years, maybe five. And I don't know how many people here know our history and our people from 10 years ago or from 20 years ago. We're celebrating 40 years of affirmation as an organization. And where are the 30-year-old members in this room? There are a couple, but there should be a lot more. My affirmation in the future would have that depth that I hope that we can reestablish. Well, thank you, Northwest panel. And thank you, audience, for putting it out there, those of you that did. In closing, is there any burning question that anybody has for the panel? Will.
So, my name is Will. I had a question regarding your experiences post, I guess, or even like staying in church or even like as you're in transition, how is the cultural element of being, I think we saw a little bit of that just now, how is being culturally Mormon still impacting your life in ways that you notice from people that were not raised LDS? And I know for me, one thing that just stood out was the idea of having to maybe temper my emotions and not express them as I want to. But that, as that is part of Mormon culture. It's part of, you know, being a little bit more subdued and such. So I was just wanting to pose that back to you. It's like, how is being Mormon, or I guess gay Mormon, LGBTQ Mormon, how does that change, you know, when you're interacting with people and day-to-day interactions?
Sort of a rule about going to church last year, and I decided that I wouldn't go unless I was willing to be a participant, and be a participant as my authentic self, which I had never done. I started to do it the year before, but I was a passive attendee. So the
one of the first fasting testimony meetings I went back after having attended the International Affirmation Conference, and I decided to bear my testimony about growing up gay in the Mormon Church and about my experience watching the youth program and how envious I was that there was a program like that now and how much it would have changed my entire life if I had been able to be true to myself through my teens and my 20s. And bearing my testimony about that in my word. It's not totally out of the norm, but it still throws people off. I go to the Elliott Bay one, and that is, you know, there are a few of us here from that room. And it's a downtown Seattle ward, so there are quite a few characters in the ward anyway.
But that wasn't where I stopped. I there have been other Sundays where I bore my testimony. I reached out and I will say comments in Relief Society about feeling the spirit around, you know, dating a certain woman and about how to, and you know, feeling prompted and legitimately so, feeling prompted that going forward in dating women is something I would not have done had it not been for spiritual promptings reminding me what the grace of Christ is for. And I think in being authentic to who I really am, it makes me vulnerable. I get a lot of weird looks on Sundays, and I'm definitely not there every Sunday anymore. So I get approached, and it's interesting living in that space of being authentic, because I really hadn't before, and I hadn't been very vocal in church. But I still, I think that's sort of my goal is, I want to participate only if I can be authentic. I want to go and visit wards and tell my story and to bear my soul and let people know that I'm real and I'm not the only one. And I guess kind of would be nice to I guess have people really get to know what a gay person is like.
I like wrapping my brain to try and think of what sets me apart as a cultural woman versus other LGBT people who may not be woman and how that makes me different. And I guess it's really hard to say because there's so much repression and shame and that are experienced for all LGBT people, not just religious LGBT people or Mormon LGBT. So it makes it, I think, really hard to discern what's because I'm Mormon, what's just because I'm LGBT. To me, a really big thing that impacted me as a Mormon LGBT person growing up, I think, and I don't know if this is like an appropriate context to like discuss this, but it's something that I guess has been in my mind since it was brought up in a discussion in the international conference that I feel like should be discussed more, is sex shame and like shame of your body and knowing your body. And I feel like that's something that is prevalent in lots of religious communities, is that repression and that feeling like if you dare be sexual with yourself or with others, that you are being sinful or that you're on a path to sin, or it just feels dirty and wrong, and in a way that it shouldn't be. Because that's how we learn who we are, and that's how we all learn who we are here, because we're all LGBT, or most of us are here. And that has to do with sexual things and body things, and all these things that we're told not to think about that are wrong and dirty and taboo. And that's really the core of a lot of our issues. They're connected to our bodies and our genitalia and our sex and things like that. And I think being a person with Mormon background definitely set me up for a longer period of time of not finding myself because it was wrong to do so in the way that I needed to find myself. I guess I don't really know how to expand that more. That had a big impact on me.
Thank you, panel, for sharing your feelings, your observations, your life, your experience. Appreciate you being here. And, and be willing to kind of put it out there in front of everybody.